you. I'm going to be doing this a lot to David today. So just know that that's for him to turn the slide. Not that, as I said, he needs constant reinforcement. So good job, David, already. When Reverend Michael, about a month ago, asked me for the title of my talk and told me that the theme was oneness, my first reaction was, are you kidding me? Haven't you read the headlines? Don't you know what's going on? The divisions, the conditions of the world, the factions. All I could see was a separation. I know, not an appropriate response for a minister, but I truly did go blank. I just saw all that was divided. But then I started thinking a little creatively, and I thought, okay, there are about 7.5 billion people on the planet right now, and even if we are divided by one issue per person, that's 7.5 billion divided by 7.5 billion, which equals one. So I had to illogically come to this oneness talk, which I know, it's convoluted, but I had to get myself into this oneness stuff. Just for a moment, I want you to look around the room and ignore anybody who's wearing blue. Just notice the other colors, okay? Look around. Okay. How many of you saw blue while you were looking for the other colors? Okay. That's kind of how it was when I was getting ready to do this talk on oneness. All I could see was the opposite of what I was looking for, because I was so intently saying, oh, I can't see this, I can't see this. It's kind of like that in life, when you're so trying to avoid something, like not thinking of a pink elephant. So it's looking for something that you want to see. In order for me to find a true connection or unity with my source, I often turn to nature for answers. Once I started remembering where I came from, where we all came from, then I felt the floodgates begin to open up with inspiration. Now, I initially had to go back a ways. I mean, a long, long ways. Anyone remember the Big Bang? I think we were all just little glimmering specks in the eyes of God. According to most scientists, the universe began with a single spot which exploded outwards. Now, the spot can't be pinpointed, as it occurred everywhere all at once. We literally all came from one, hence the title of my talk, All From One and One For All. About 13.8 billion years ago, the universe sprang into existence from a subatomic size to a golf ball size in almost an instant. That means when it was only, now listen closely, I'm not repeating numbers here, a hundredth of a billionth of a trillionth of a trillionth of a second in age, the universe doubled in size at least 90 times. Don't try that at home. And we have been expanding outwards ever since. So for those first 380,000 years or so, the universe was essentially too hot for even light to shine. Sounds kind of like a pickup line. Once it began to chill a little from its 10 billion degrees, also known as the first hot flash ever recorded, an afterglow began to form. It's mind-boggling when I think about it, right? So without getting all sciencey on you, which is impossible since I said the word sciencey, let me suffice it to say that a whole lot of change, expansion, exploding, and collapsing all occurred almost at once. About 5 or 6 billion years ago, a mysterious force called dark energy, not to be confused with the dark side, as it was all good, but it began speeding up the expansion of the universe. And it continues to this day. It looks kind of like this. Yep, scientists couldn't see anything either, because it's dark energy. And the older the universe gets, the quicker the expansion seems to be. We are currently accelerating outwards at a faster rate than they ever predicted possible, kind of like a balloon inflating in all directions at once. Think about it, those galaxies speeding outwards, it's going to be harder and harder for ET to phone home. But the universe is so vast that when the Hubble telescope was out roaming around, it decided to focus in on a black area like this, and it found the most desolate spot it could find outside of the Big Dipper. And then they decided to zoom in on it, and this is what they saw. 10,000 plus galaxies spiraling around. It's truly amazing when you think about it, how in this spot of blackness, this is what they discovered. Now, I know it's difficult to, like, lose a sock, but how do you lose 10,000 galaxies? But the technology, we're always discovering more and more about science. And what's really amazing is that all the matter that we can see, including all this, all the matter on Earth, all the black holes, the huge gaseous clouds, everything that we could see with telescopes, with not, makes up only 5% of the matter that scientists have detected. It's all invisible to us. And that's amazing that there's 95% of things that we can't see. So in addition to this dark energy, there's also something called dark matter that scientists have discovered that make up that 95%. And due to how it interacts with things around it, dark matter responds in a totally peculiar way, but they can see the way it curves around other forms, so they know it exists. There is so much creation out there that began with a single speck. Thus, we are all entangled from our very beginning. Astrophysicist Carrie Shriver once wrote, "Everything in us originated in cosmic explosions billions of years ago. All the elements that exist in stars exist in our bodies as well." So we are literally all made of stardust. These are called the pillars of creation. And if you ever start to wonder if there's a higher power, I encourage you to look at some of these photos from Hubble. It's just amazing how beautiful they are. We get the calcium in our bodies from supernovas exploding, and our red blood cells came from chemical reactions that can be traced back to the Big Bang. I don't know about you, but I feel a little more powerful knowing that I came from a supernova. It's like a new superhero kind of thing that we should all embrace. Adding to this, Einstein discovered something, well, he was confused about it at first, and he called it spooky action at a distance, or quantum entanglements. Some of you might be familiar with this. To simplify this kind of complex idea, I need a volunteer. Denise, would you mind coming up here, please? I'm trusting you're not too shy. So, first of all, just a guess. First of all, Denise and I, you're now a particle. Are you good with that?
Yes.
Okay, good. We're going to have a little entanglement here. So let's just quickly dance around. Okay. I'm not sure how particles entangle, but that's good enough for us. Now, scientists have proven that despite how far apart the particles become after that initial entanglement, if I spin around, Denise would spin around automatically at the same time. And then if Denise were launched 10,000 miles right now, away from me, not that you have to do that, into space, if I decided to do a sudden backflip, she would do one at the same instant. Go ahead, no? Okay. Okay, so thank you. You're a great particle. So what's mind-boggling is that there's no communication between us. No cell phones, no yelling, no. It's just instantaneous that these particles, once they were mingled, they can now operate instantaneously. So as once again, mind-boggling, hang on to this idea because we're going to come back to it. What does all this space stuff have to do with oneness? When I did research for this talk, I was trying to find a direct link between our thoughts and all this invisible energy. And I thought, as scientists are able to find more about this unseen mass that makes up the force of the universe, they have discovered something recently called the God particle. I'm sure you've heard of that. And it gives mass to all things. In fact, without the God particle, would be a cold, dark universe. And then I started thinking, okay, so if I can't necessarily find where the scientists are saying that our thoughts become this God particle, I had to remember our teaching. In science of mind, we believe that all things are God. We're all God particles. We are constantly, or are we constantly waiting for things to be validated and labeled by scientists before we can believe in them? I know that I don't understand how my car works, but I believe that it does most days. Are there mysteries that, from our limited perspective, are difficult to unlock? Do we need to understand them in order for them to work? Think about machinery in your own home. It's kind of like trying to describe the base of an elephant's foot when we might be a little speck out on the tip of his tail. The Dr. Seuss story, you're familiar with that, Horton Hears a Who, is appropriate here. However, are we Horton or are we who? And who's on Horton's base? We can't, forget that bad joke. We can't see wind or gravity or love, but we know they exist. We have particles that appear to be camera shy, yet we know they move through us all the time. Scientists have validated them at the skeletal base in which all matter clusters. They speculate that it's kind of like a prototype or a matrix that galaxies form upon. We know our thoughts create things. Maybe this is a link in that chain of manifestation. Our thoughts help make the patterns in which our lives form. Let's come down to earth for a moment and get a little physical. Think about all the unity or oneness that we can actually see on our planet. We talk about having different oceans, but in reality, they are all connected by one big, massive body of water. It covers about 70% of our planet. Coincidentally, our bodies are made up of 70% of water. Our world is also made up of seven primary plates that interact with one another. When one moves or shifts, it has an impact on the others. Now, on to us Homo sapiens. All humans have 99.5% DNA in common. But now look at your fingerprints for a moment. No two are alike. Turn briefly, if you can, to your neighbor. And I want you to just look in their eyes and notice their irises, the colored part that expands and contracts with the pupil. No two irises are alike. Even those on your own face, they are different. They are formed in utero, and so the muscular patterns all develop in a different way. I don't know about you, but it truly makes me feel humbled about how beautiful we have in common, but we also have these differences. Since no two people have this same DNA, we are all a beautiful human tapestry. Think how boring it would be if we all looked the same. One big beige blanket. We are created as individual expressions of the one. This is what the 5% looks like. That beautiful array of colors. This month's Science of Mind magazine, I don't know if anybody's read it yet, but I started writing my talk before I saw October's issue, and I was startled to see how there's space stuff on it. And also, on October 12th, Ernest Holmes writes something that is, okay, I'm going to use my glasses because sometimes I just can't see the words and then I make up stuff and it's not good for any of us. So, the friend within you is different from all other persons, yet he is united with all. There is some part of you which reaches into the nature of others, thus irresistibly drawing them to you and drawing you to them, binding all together in one complete unity. Right now, you are one with all persons, all places, all events. And that's taken from his writing, Your Invisible Power. So he must have known about dark energy. We are all connected as humans, one thing affecting all. We have adjusted the use of our chemicals so that we've limited acid rain. We've stopped using aerosols to protect the ozone layer. We are trying to clean up the oceans. We're attempting to deal with climate change, and we know the impacts that humans can make for better or for worse. How can we have a healthy planet, both physically and psychically, when we pretend there are no connections? It's as if I didn't like my big toe, and so I chopped it off. It would affect my entire body. When we deny others resources or oxygen, it reminds me of when I used to try and sit in the non-smoking section of an airplane. We have this interconnected system. And physical issues aside, our consciousness can affect the planet as well. During massive events, such as natural disasters or 9/11 or other major attacks, there has been a major impact on the group consciousness. People do come together, though. The stories that have united people in response to tragic events have been truly heartwarming. People donating time, talent, and treasure is inspirational. We have heard many stories of people connecting over the past days, weeks, and even months. Through challenging times, they persist to come up, the healers, the helpers. Those are amazing sources of human kindness. There's something called the Global Consciousness Project. Anyone ever hear of this? To simply explain it, about 15 years ago, they began collecting data from a random number generator, and they've seen patterns spike or peak during major global events that captivated our minds and our hearts. Thus, they can measure people's emotional response to as on a mass population scale. Studies have also been done where people come together in groups and they meditate on specific cities or areas, and they've seen a decrease in crime during that time period. We have a New Year's Eve meditation through Science of Mind. All the churches come together on New Year's, and we agree on a specific time, and we sit and focus on peace and unity and oneness around the planet. Anybody ever do this experience here? I highly recommend it. It's a bonding and truly powerful time. Since our teaching is based on spiritual practices, I'd like to lead you on one right now, which is a guided meditation. And so if you will, just get comfortable in your chair and take a deep breath in. And as you exhale, let your eyes gently close. I'd like you to focus your energy into your heart center, visioning a golden ball of light. Allow it to begin to radiate through your entire body, relaxing as it goes. Feel it extending down to your feet, grounding you with the earth. Sense it through your arms and chest and head as it rises up, allowing a joyous, wonderful feeling that fills your entire being with peace. It can no longer be contained just inside your body. And so it energetically moves beyond your skin. Notice how it hovers out all over and around you, like a growing aura. Where do you end and those around you begin? Is there still a border? How are you connected to others? Let your golden light fill up the room with all those surrounding you, like a pulsing star in the night sky. This energy becomes brighter and brighter with each breath you take. Notice that the light from all the people in this room cannot be captured within this building. So it expands outward, radiating energetically throughout all of Chico. Now imagine it spiraling directly to all those who need healing in whatever form that may be. Send loving thoughts out to all human beings who may be suffering at this time. Whether through fires or hurricanes or other challenges, remember those God particles are everywhere. You are also part of a giant quantum entanglement, a giant matrix of cosmic joy. Your loving energy affects things far away, faster than the speed of light. There is far more that connects than separates us. Allow your light to remain extended, even as you hear the sound of the chime. Please bring your focus back into the room as you still remain conscious of the loving energy that you've extended outward, that you'll always be entangled with. When you're ready, open your eyes and look around the room at all the beautiful beings around you. And now I'd like to play a short video. It's a YouTube clip that has it has music from John Denver, so please enjoy. It's called It's About Time.
There's a full moon over India. Gandhi lives again. Who's to say you have to lose for someone else to win? In the eyes of all the people, the look is much the same. For the first is just the last one. When you play a deadly game, it's about time we realize it. We're all in this together. It's about time we find out it's all of us or none. It's about time we recognize it. These changes in the weather. It's about time. It's about changes. And it's about time. There's a light in the Vatican window for all the world to see. And a voice cries in the wilderness. Sometimes he speaks for me. I suppose I love him most of all when he kneels to kiss the land. With his lips upon our mother's breast, he makes his strongest stand. It's about time we start to see it. The earth is our only home. It's about time start to face it. We can't make it here all alone. It's about time we start to listen to the voices in the wind. It's about said it's about time. There's a man who is my brother, I just don't know his name. But I know his home and family, because I know we feel the same. And it hurts me when he's hungry and when his children cry. I too am a father, that little one is mine. It's about time we begin it, to turn the world around. It's about time we start to make it, the dream we've always known. It's about time we start to live it, the family of man. It's about time, it's about changes, and it's about time. It's about peace, and it's about plenty, and it's about time. It's about you and me together, and it's about time.
It is about time. We have to ask ourselves, what do we do next? We have this unlimited universal energy that, like dark matter, we are all particles of. This responds to our thoughts, and the universe delights in expressing as us. Like our inflating cosmos, we expand in consciousness through not just our words, but our acts as well. We are divine manifestations of the universe on the leading edge of creation. We can continue to focus on the type of world that we choose to live in. We can lay those prototypes out with our thought processes. And yet, we also believe in treating and moving our feet. For those who are interested, you can go on the CSL Santa Rosa website and donate to the fire victims, because they have a great setup there that you can just pay directly to the people there. And I invite you to do that. There's also something in 2 weeks called Chico Make a Difference Day, October 28th. And it's sponsored by the Chico Chamber of Commerce. And it's ways that you can also make a difference here locally. There are plenty of things to do, to get involved in, to make a positive difference in the world. Since Chico was originally the home of Native Americans, I would like to read to you now something from a writing from a Hopi elder. He says, "You have been telling the people that this is the 11th hour. Now you must go back and tell the people that this is the hour, and there are things to be considered. Where are you living? What are you doing? What are your relationships? Are you in right relation? Where is your water? Know your garden. It is time to speak your truth. Create your community. Be good to each other. And do not look outside yourself for the leader." Then he clasped his hands together, smiled, and said, "This could be a good time. There is a river flowing now very fast. It is so great and swift that there are those who will be afraid. They will try and hold on to the shore. They will feel they are torn apart and will suffer greatly. No, the river has its destination. The elders say we must let go of the shore, push off into the middle of the river, keep our eyes open and our heads above water. And I say, see who is in there with you and celebrate. At this time in history, we are to take nothing personally, least of all ourselves. For the moment that we do, our spiritual growth and journey comes to a halt. The time for the lone wolf is over. Gather yourselves. Banish the word struggle from your attitude and your vocabulary. All that we do now must be done in a sacred manner and in celebration. We are the ones we've been waiting for. We are all beings of light, constantly evolving upward with the potential to make a difference on so many levels. Remember, we do all come from one, and one for all. Namaste.